So today it's conservation biology, looking first at big issues such as human demography, wealth creation, and the civilizational issues which are at the root of environmental problems. And if we want to do something with the biodiversity conservation, we need to at least understand, if not address these issues, and then we can go to specific conservation measures for certain species or certain habitats. So there are, of course, levels of generality to conservation. And since we have only one lecture for community ecology, I am going to address the high level issues rather than how you can conserve certain individual communities or certain individual types of, or deal with certain individual types of threats. So we will start with the most general question, what actually we want from biodiversity conservation. The problem with biodiversity conservation is that it's based on scientific understanding of ecology, obviously, but at the same time, it's a political activity. Yeah, you can't scientifically prove that we have to conserve something or something else. There are no scientific no scientific base for lots of action, because that also depends on human priorities, and these are matter of the politics. So obviously we want some kind of outcomes which are universally shared, like preventing catastrophe which will damage our civilization, but that's as far as it goes. Then when it comes to the details, then even environmentally conscious people can have actually very different motivations and very different priorities. So why biodiversity conservation? Well, there are different arguments. There is a moral argument about having no right to harm living organisms and ecosystems. Then E.O. Wilson promoted the term biophilia, noting that most people find biodiversity interesting and aesthetically pleasing, and so we simply like it. We like nature, and so that's a motivation to protect it. Some people take a more narrow view of health motivation. Basically, biodiversity is essential for healthy life and pleasing environment. Then there is a purely utilitarian argument that there are money to be made out of biodiversity, be it finding new medications or ecosystem services which we need. And then there is also a social engineering element in some biodiversity movements. Basically, some people see the problems we have with biodiversity and look at ways of changing the society alongside of protecting this biodiversity. And sometimes it's actually the main motivation would be the change of the society, and a certain element of biodiversity conservation is sort of used as a means to achieve societal change. And that is a very real but not very helpful element of biodiversity conservation. So we scientists, we need to provide scenarios. We need to tell, look, if you are going to go in this direction, if you are going to release certain amount of carbon dioxide, then we will have a warming of climate by certain number of degrees, which has this and these consequences. If we cause extinction of these organisms, this will be the effects on the functionality of ecosystems. These are the arguments which society needs to hear, and then can make more informed decisions. By the way, we see this role of science and also sometimes failing of science in the current COVID crisis, where there is a legitimate scientific discussion about a lot of aspects of how to deal with it, but then there is some clear scientific advice which is not accepted by a significant part of society and the politicians, and that is the real problem. So back to biodiversity conservation. My argument is that the primary problem of human planetary impact is human population. Again, this is itself actually a matter for dispute or discussion. The growing human population creates a lot of secondary problems: species extinctions, pollution, non-sustainable resource use, habitat destruction, fragmentation, alien biota, and so on. But basically, the impact of these factors depends on how many people are there on Earth. I think Jane Goodall and Sir David Attenborough have a good perspective on this. Goodall says it's our population growth that underlies just about every single one of the problems that we have inflicted on the planet. And the counter argument, there is actually a discussion about this, there is counter argument that it's developed countries which are causing most of environmental damage, and because they have a high per capita ecological footprint, and that poor people do not matter environmentally, which there is of course some logic in that argument, but when you think about this, then there are only two options which this argument implies. Either the poor people of today and their children, the next generation, will be either rich people of tomorrow and therefore environmentally significant, or poor people of tomorrow. And that sort of implies that there are certain population segments, certain countries, which will never in foreseeable future escape poverty and will remain ecologically insignificant as a consequence. And that is not an acceptable argument. Basically, there is the biodiversity conservation is not 100% absolute priority of the entire civilization. That I think would be consensus of people. There are other priorities, and one is reducing and eliminating poverty. And that automatically means that even underdeveloped countries matter populationally, and so growth of population there is of concern. There is obviously one very nice example of how this matter. The people arguing that the growth of population doesn't matter should look at China. The same argument could have been developed in the 1950s, 60s, 70s when ecological footprint of China was negligible. But the population was growing, and then it got rich, or relatively rich. And as a consequence, the ecological footprint of China is huge currently. And for instance, for the climate change aspect, it's actually the most important of all countries currently. So that's exactly the scenario of poor people getting rich tomorrow, and that tomorrow for China is already now. And so the population size argument is an important one. That some people even politicize that focus on population is neo-colonialist, because of course it happens that this is developing countries which are currently growing in population, and we will explain why it's exactly like that, and there is a reason for that. And so if somebody downplays the importance of increasing population, then basically is telling that there will never be economic advancement for poor people, which I don't think is a very realistic or very pleasant perspective. So now let's have a look at some of these countries. And as I mentioned, the China transformation from 1950s to 1920s, to 2020s is very instructive. Yeah, this is This is the emission of carbon dioxide by countries. And in the 1997, the Kyoto Protocol, the first international attempt to curb CO2, considered China of low importance alongside with other underdeveloped countries, and so was not even included in the Kyoto Protocol. While when you look at 2018, China is actually more important than the entire Europe, yeah, both European Union and the rest of the Europe. It's more important than the United States. This is the relative share of individual countries on carbon dioxide, and so China equals USA plus 28 European Union countries combined. Even when we look, you can say, well, yeah, that's current situation, but when we accumulate all the carbon dioxide historically, it will be still developed countries. Yes, it's true, but China is already number three in the historical accounting when we will accumulate all the carbon dioxide emitted throughout the industrial history. And so that also changed the politics of Kyoto type agreements, because in Kyoto, there was really focus on developed countries, and it can't be politically feasible any longer because these are actually emitting a minority of significant minority of the emissions. So nowadays that distinction has changed. Okay, why is this change in China? Well, the GDP per person simply run away in China from other countries. There is the per capita GDP for China starting from 1950 relative to that year, and so the GDP improved in China 15 times, and then especially striking in the comparison with India and then Nigeria, as well as developed countries like United Kingdom, United States, who thought were doing well, and that meant increasing GDP per capita twice. And at the same time, the China had significant rise in population. And that was the same as in India, but India is lacking that kind of economic development. So we can ask legitimately, is India going to be the next China? Yeah, because in terms of population, it will become the largest country in the world very soon. You can see that it's on the trajectory for that. And if there is the same, there is still a wealth gap between India and China, but of course India is doing all it can to close it. And when the countries are getting richer, then their emission intensity is actually getting worse at the beginning. So that means that the efficiency, how they create a unit of wealth in terms of carbon dioxide release, at least in the current technological level of industry, is actually getting worse. And so the country not only is getting production higher and wealth higher, but also the wealth creation is more harmful for environment than in the developed countries, because then their industries are becoming cleaner, environmental regulation more stringent, and that's why their emission efficiency goes down again. So here is the danger that India will, if it industrialize in the way China did, then it will become bulk producer of emissions corresponding to that increase in wealth, but also loss of efficiency, which is exactly what happened in China. So it will go up along this curve before it goes down. So we are now concerned again in Europe about carbon dioxide, and we have a very ambitious and also controversial, potentially extremely expensive zero carbon policies in EU. But the success of this globally will to large extent depend what happens in China, whether China will reduce it its emission as well, but also, and that is less political issue nowadays, what happened in India, because it's well possible that India will close this wealth gap with China, in which case, unless the technology is really going carbonless, will the anticipated increase in emissions will actually almost wipe out the gains from entire Europe and US going carbon neutral, which of course it's a big question whether carbon neutral will happen in the US, but even if it happens in Europe, it will be completely insignificant if India goes the way China went. Now we can go even further and we can ask whether Nigeria is going to be the next China, because these are the demographics prediction for population to the end of the century. And so first you can see that China, because of one policy, one child policy, which we will be discussing later, China is actually demographically in decline, and it will, the population will be aging, and so the India will replace China as the most populous country at the end of the century. But Nigeria, probably there is a lot of uncertainty into demography of Africa, as again we will discuss, but the best prediction for Nigeria is that it will become second most populous country at the end of the century. That means it will overtake China. That might be quite unexpected based on the current situation in Nigeria, but where it is actually behind Indonesia and behind Pakistan. But remember that the human population growth is exponential. And now you can think about COVID waves of infections, how fast exponential growth can go if the reproduction factor is over one. And that's basically what's happening in Nigeria so far. And the big question is whether it will go this direction as well. So when we look at the number of working age adults in the country, then currently China has the largest workforce available, but it's at the peak right now, or even the decline already started. And so from now on, the number of workers in China will be declining because of the age structure of the population, while in India it will probably peak in the middle of the century. 2045 is the best prediction, and then it will decline. So at the end of the century, Nigeria will have also second highest workforce, and on the course of being the first highest workforce, since India would be already declining and China will be already below Nigeria. So again, we need to look at, also what happens in Nigeria. So for instance, these are the top 25 economies by size, and you can see United States are the first. They will still be first for some time. They are predicted to lose that first spot to China at the middle of the century. But interestingly, because of the Chinese demography going down and this workforce going down, US is actually predicted to regain the first spot at the end of century. Of course, these kind of predictions are more game than serious. Nobody can predict economy 100 years ahead or 80 years ahead. But there are sort of solid reasons for this kind of prediction. India should be raising in the ranks, taking third spot, but Nigeria, which is currently number 28, is predicted to actually race to number 9 at the end of the century. So, when we are thinking about ecological footprint of different countries, we have to think, some of the conclusions are rather surprising unless you know the data. You can't just go by your intuition. Now, speaking about carbon dioxide, which is not the main topic of this lecture, but a good example, we see that even now carbon dioxide emissions are very closely correlated with wealth of the nations. And since everybody wants to get rich, then that's the underlying cause of reluctance of limiting carbon dioxide, unless there is change in technology. These are individual countries. The size of the bubble corresponds to size of the country, and this is the per person income against per capita carbon dioxide emissions. And you can basically see for such a complex phenomena as wealth of the nation and carbon dioxide, you can see extremely, extremely close correlation. And you can even say that no country emitting enough carbon dioxide managed to stay poor, because this area is empty. Yeah, there is no high emission, low income country. The closest is North Korea, which came pretty close, but still not there, although working on it. So how to solve these problems, such as carbon dioxide, but also biodiversity extinction? Well, there are two groups of people in that, techno-optimists and techno-pessimists. Techno-optimists will say that technological progress solves more problems than it causes. I mean, nobody doubts that technology got us into some problems, like use of the fossil fuel and therefore climate change. But the genuine optimism is that technological progress solves more problems than it causes. But there is also sort of semi-optimism, which will say that we have gone too far to stop playing now with technology, that currently the technology already caused problems which can only be solved by even better and more developed technology. And so if we stopped, if we become sort of Luddite, averse to technology, then these problems will still be there, and you know, will have serious impact. So the solution is more technology to increase or maintain wealth of nations consumption, and therefore be politically feasible also for nature protection. And then another significant portion of environmental thinking is techno-pessimist, saying that technological progress is dangerous, causes net increase in problems. And so we should be very suspicious about new technologies and try to curb them. And so solution is not more, but perhaps even less technology and less consumption. There are two problems. First, less technology will definitely cause lower consumption. And that is not politically feasible, let's face it. And so that means we could only institute serious measures which make people poorer by other means than democratic process. But we have already experienced that once you do that, then typically that system will make people poor, that's true, but not achieve what it is designed to. When you think about the communist regime, then it basically decided that the wealth of workers' class is so important than its worth of abandoning democracy and forcefully improving the standards of working class. After several decades of this experiment in different countries all over the world, the conclusion was that democracy was indeed dispensed of, and the conditions of working class got actually worse. And I believe that this would actually happen with dictatorially instituted conservation, that it will make actually conservation worse rather than better, while at the same time genuinely reducing consumption and making people poor. So what's the solution? Again, it's politics, so there is no objective truth in that, but I strongly believe that techno-optimism is the way to go. The solutions of environmental problems, it's basically, again, a Malthusian problem, yeah? That the population is increasing geometrically. Technology has to keep pace with supplying this population in a way which will not destroy the planet. And that subsistence tends to increase in arithmetic ratio. That's Thomas Malthus, and very influential essay. Yeah, there is this is the citations of his book. Of course, the peak citation based on Google was shortly in the first 30 years in the early 19th century after it was published, but it maintains very healthy citation to these days, which you can't really say about every book published in at the start of the 19th century. So it's an essay on the principle of the population, and basically examines how the technological and other progress works. Interestingly, the current system of our economy and its impact on environment was not always like we are used to it. There has been, currently we have technological progress generates increased wealth per capita. And that's why it's so popular, and that's why governments invest so much in technology, and you know, why we think it's the main reason for progress. But for several centuries, it looks like economy, improved economy and technology produced additional people, not increased prosperity. This is a trajectory where you have the population size against GDP per capita, although I'm sure that calculation of gross domestic product per person for year 1300 is quite challenging, but basically you have the situation here where there is sort of stagnant economy in the 13th century, and then Black Death killed half of the population, basically. This is for Great Britain. So it killed half of the population. So population goes down, and then it created demands for, you know, shortage of workforce, and so there is an increased GDP per capita. And then for more than 200 years, you have this horizontal line here where the further progress did not change GDP and created a steady increase in population. So we moved back to where the population was before the epidemics, and then beyond that. And only at late 17th century, there is a change in the dynamics where the economy starts creating wealth per capita rather than increasing people. Increasing people as well, but much less exclusive. When you look at how the trajectory moves in the 18th century, then the wealth per capita is much more prominent than increase in population, which of course continues. And so that's where we are now. This is another such analysis which shows for the year 1500 different countries. Land productivity, which was, of course, nowadays Silicon Valley is not famous for its almonds and oranges, although they do grow them there, but for technology. In these years, the land productivity was the main wealth. And so the income per capita has no connection with land productivity. But it has a fair connection with population density. So again, the wealth of, in this case, agriculture products creates new people, not new wealth. However, that dynamics completely changed at the 19th-20th century. So you can see different countries, GDP per capita just really got off the charts. It's basically what China experienced recently, the As you can see here, then the European countries, Japan, and later on US experience a bit sooner. So this Malthusian economy producing people, not per capita wealth, is a mode of economy which would be completely alien to us. Yeah, there is a period of 500 years here on this graph, which basically shows some fluctuation, but more or less no change in per capita income. Yeah, for 500 years. By the way, this also another interesting feature is the lack of inflation. That some of the prices, you know, there are documents where certain building, certain house was purchased for certain price, and after two generations was sold for nominally the same amount of money in a given currency. So, you know, that is something which is quite alien to us. Now, with the technological progress, again, we typically, when we think about it, we don't really understand it well. There are lots of surprising features. It tends to develop in unpredictable directions. Yeah, when you think of where we live at the moment, then everybody predicted flying cars, and we don't have them yet, but nobody predicted internet. Yeah, this is the Time magazine cover in 1965, which basically still thinks of computers as big machines, which you know, in the corporate environment, not in the daily lives. Although it was not so long before Tim Berners-Lee invented World Wide Web in 1991. This is the first WWW page started on 6 August in 1991. So again, the effects of internet were unpredictable, even when it was invented. You know, I remember concerns about how it will increase the gap between developing and developed countries, because computers were so expensive, and access to information. Nobody realized that it's actually much nowadays, when prices went down, it's actually perfect for developing countries. You only need a relatively cheap computer and some connection, which may be a problem, but then you can connect to libraries which are so large and complex that they could never be maintained inside that country. So internet really democratized access to information between the developing and developed countries. But when you look at the articles in the 90s, they all were concerned about exactly opposite. Likewise, nobody was able to predict social networks, Facebook and others, and their effect on society. So basically, we can't see the effect of technological progress. And then another interesting feature is that how fast it can be in some fields. We know all very well the so-called Moore's law, which is sort of empirical prediction of exponential growth in the number of transistors on a integrated computer chips, which the Gordon Moore, the founder of Intel, in 1975 predicted will double every 2 years. And that Moore's law, with some modification, I think it's 2.5 years now, has been actually going on for much longer than anybody expected. This is the 1971 all the way to 2019, which is actually, again, this is the number of transistors is a logarithmic scale. So it starts at below 10,000 and it ends at 10 billion so far. So, you know, this is the what you see here is the hard drive of the capacity of 5 megabytes in 1956, offloaded from a plane. Genome sequencing, yeah, the cost of sequencing one base. Again, everybody was excited to see that it follows Moore's law. But then in 2007, with new technologies, it really took off the charts and went super exponential. And that's where we are now. So so again, you know, you can in 2000, which is 20 years ago, you can sequence. You had to pay more than 10,000 times more for sequencing per DNA base than you pay now. Even chickens follow Moore's law. Yeah, there is a paper. This is the size of the industrially produced chicken at a 56 day age when they get slaughtered, and you can see that based on these three data points, the weight of 50 days old chicken doubles every 20 years. Yeah, from 57 to 2005. So we are basically close to testing that law again in 2025, where we would have to have 8.5 kilogram chickens, which I am not really sure will happen. Now, lots of technologies exhibit an exponential decrease in costs. So that's basically the other side of the Moore's law. For instance, here again, there is a cost of solar energy on logarithmic scale per kilowatt hour. And you can see that, again, it goes really off the charts. I remember in year 2000, we were actually starting to use solar panels in our field expeditions in New Guinea. And it was extremely expensive unit, not very productive. Nowadays, everybody has solar energy in areas where there is no electrical grid. That's actually one of the biggest improvements in the lives of rural people in developing countries, together with mobile telephony. And again, not many predictions went that direction. It's not of course a general rule. You can see that the cost of nuclear power actually did not go that way, and it actually increased over the time. And again, you can see the politics behind that. If we invested as much into solar as in nuclear, then we might be somewhere else. There are some other issues. There are some other industries which have different trajectories here. So different types of hardware go fast down in cost, while production of food goes much slower, not surprisingly. And then there are the genomics, the sequencing goes the fastest of all. Now the technological progress can be rapid. These are for United States. This is the percentage of households adopting different innovations. So the electric power is red, and then flushing toilets is green, and then running water. But the abandonment of technology can also be fast. This is the decline in landline telephony. So when we look at United States again, then the electricity went from 20% of households to pretty much 100% in 20 years, and then followed by even steeper curve for computer, where you get from 20% of households to 80% in 10 years. And then it went equally fast internet, and after that, equally fast social media usage. So that means that electricity brought us social bubbles on Facebook in only 100 years time. Of course, the technology creates unforeseen problems. Nobody really claims otherwise. For instance, there was a big problem with traffic in towns. Yeah, the New York in 1900 had 170,000 horses and for public transport, and they produced 2,000 tons of manure every day. And so there were very dire predictions that if it will go like that, then in 50 years, there would be real crisis in towns with the 9 feet of manure all over the roads by extrapolation. But then automobile scams. And so automobile was actually originally also a solution to environmental crisis with horse manure. And again, in US, United States went from 80% of horses and 20% of automobiles in 1910 to the reverse ratio in mere 10 years. That's a bit extreme, but that just show, you know, again, today we are discussing how fast we can replace diesel and petrol cars with electromobiles. Of course, it depends how attractive is the technology, but if it's attractive, it's economically sensible, it can be actually very fast. You know, you can argue that skeptics could have argued that it's impossible to replace horses fast. There are all these stables, the infrastructure, you know, the stables at every inn and hotel for the horses is already there. On the other hand, fuel stations are not there, have to be built. You can have a lot of concerns, but everything went in 10 years. Now, technological problems which are created can be also solved by more technology typically. That's the basis for techno-optimism. Example, ozone hole problem. That's the cause. It's a increasing ozone hole, which is O3, is protecting the Earth ecosystems from UV radiation. So there were concerns that there would be a large increase in skin cancers and mutation rate generally if this continues. In the late 70s, the ozone hole started disappearing, especially on the poles. And then in 2015, there was a very, very clear reduction, and it was caused by the cooling agents in fridges, in refrigerators, the freons basically. And so there was a global meeting, global rules, a little bit like Kyoto, started with carbon dioxide, but unlike carbon dioxide reduction efforts, it was successful. This is the decline in ozone depleting substances emissions over the years to virtually zero. It was technologically solvable. It required some investments, but not huge investments, and it worked. So stratospheric ozone concentration stopped declining, and the Antarctic ozone hole stopped growing as of today. And so we can, if we keep that lack of production, we can see that ozone hole problem solved purely by technological means. Yeah. And I think that is the way how we need to find solution for climate change. People will not accept a change in behavior, and majority of people. Of course, there is always environmentally conscious minority, but that doesn't really matter. Minority is not what is at stake here. And then you can see that if we went alternative way with ozone hole, that means not looking into new technology, but behavioral change, like some people do with climate change. They are saying, don't fly because, you know, that's the only way to save planet. Likewise, people could say that, you know, save the planet, stop refrigeration. You know, we have 100% households having fridge. Why don't we go down and get rid of refrigerators? You know, people have now are inventing Scandinavian terms of discomfort from the use of plane. They could have said, killing scam, guilt from using a fridge, or shame from air conditioning, and then have all these kind of social activities around that, which are arguably they are fun, but they don't lead anywhere. You know, you can tell that with this kind of approach, we would have a huge ozone hole problem nowadays, because, you know, people will not give up refrigeration, simple, you know, plain and simple. And so the current approach to, counting carbon footprint and making people guilty is very problematic because, as we saw, there is a very close correlation between economy and carbon. So basically, whatever you do, you can always turn it into a negative aspect into carbon production. Yeah, there is a book which is has a very apt title on that, and that is that's called "Work is Ruining the World." So basically, you know, any activity you do finally is increasing carbon footprint, because that's how our current economy works. So the only solution is to change that base of economy, change the technology. Otherwise, we are doomed. You know, you can calculate, you know, every single activity and the carbon footprint, you know, washing clothes, owning the car, flying, and then, of course, the worst sin of all, having children. That really damages your carbon account, and it goes to really ridiculous lengths, which are actually damaging the image of climate change. You know, your pets, you know, you should get rid of pets. You maybe should keep hamster instead of your dog, because they have actually bigger footprint than the Land Cruiser. Yeah, Toyota Land Cruiser compared to large dog, yeah, or even medium sized dog. If you Google something on internet, it has a carbon footprint. If you have money and if you want to invest them in carbon free way, then the only advice I would have for you is to buy expensive art. You know, if you buy this painting, Jean-Michel Basquiat, was sold for $100 million dollars in 2017. Yeah, and so that's a $100 million investment, which is almost carbon free. It's the painting simply hangs on the wall, and that's all it is. Anything else you can do with $100 million dollars will make climate change worse, you can be sure. Okay, so as I said, the role of science is to create sensible predictions for what's going to happen under certain scenarios. And one of famous attempts at doing that was done by so-called Club of Rome, the informal group of scientists in 1968. This is not coincidental. That's when first computers were practically usable, and they predicted a scarcity of non-renewable materials, oil, metals, and so on, followed by the collapse of industrial production at about 2070, and therefore agriculture, and finally human population size. And so the story goes like that. We have an exponential increase in population, which leads to depletion of resources, which with some delay leads to decline in agriculture per capita production, and then industrial production, and which leads to collapse of the industrial output, and therefore collapse of population. And we should be 2020, we should be in the middle of the crisis with resources in huge decline, and already with the food per capita in decline, and general outcome per capita declining. There is, of course, a logic in that which is sound. You know, that's actually my initial argument, that you can't keep growing population exponentially endlessly. That's obvious. And so the basis is correct. You know, there is a famous quotation that anyone who believes that exponential growth can go on for forever is in a finite world is either a madman or an economist. Yeah, and so we are back at the Malthusian argument again, and I think this is essentially correct, but the Club of Rome model was too skeptical about the abilities of technological development. Yeah, basically they underestimated severely technology, and so we have delayed this scenario. We didn't cancel it, we have delayed it into the future. And as I will show, it might actually go out of the scenarios by itself, because with increasing wealth, the population growth is getting lower and lower, so we might not actually go through this catastrophe. There is an amusing story about this, that when the Club of Rome was in conclusions were promoted, then lots of economists were already skeptical, because you know they probably understood economy better than environmentalists, and therefore they could see that the resources are not really getting more we are not running out of resources as yet. And so Julian Simon, an economist, waged a bet with Paul Ehrlich. Ehrlich was supposed to pick up six minerals, and the bet was that in 10 years, 1980 to 1990, the price will increase, which was Ehrlich's prediction based on their increasing scarcity. And he lost the bet comprehensively. All six Ehrlich picked up were actually cheaper in 1990s than 1980. And this is basically a sense of, this is a sense of the model that yes, it's sound, but it severely underestimates the technology, and which is important. The reality was actually different. When you look at the food production, then it was actually increasing, and since population is also increasing, then per capita food production was increasing less nicely, but still significantly. And food price was also not going up, but going down actually. Now, when we look at undernourished people in population, then the number of undernourished people also significantly declined. This is relatively recent. This is from year 2000 to 2015. And so that's the absolute number, despite the increasing population size. So the percentage of undernourished in population, although we should be targeting zero, then it actually went from 15% to 10. So we got rid of one third of that. Now it's really easy to underestimate the power of technology. These are the yields of grain in tons per hectare in England for wheat, barley, oats. Yeah, and so when you look, England is fantastic, because whatever you ask about, they have a long-term data which goes typically 1,000 years back, and that's exactly here. This is the yield from 13th century, and you couldn't blame people in that 13th to 15th century thinking that there is some kind of biological law, or there is or God's will that sets these yields in the grains, because they haven't changed for 300 years, and but then the technology started improving, and so people could see the power of technology. Amazing, the yields improved four times in the next 400 years. And again, they had no idea that they are just before real, green revolution, which explosively further quadrupled the yields to the current day. So again, we might be now, we don't know where we are. Are we at the end of the road? Is eight tons per hectare for wheat the absolute maximum, the biological law, or God's limit, or not? Well, we might actually be in the same position as people at the year 1900, that we have seen some amazing progress by that perspective from 1900, but had no idea what will happen in the future. There is a genetic engineering which, we can get into industrial production of food out of the agriculture, out in the open entirely. We don't know, but there are certainly technology, there is no technological principle stopping that. So Green Revolution has been a success, but the technologies which helped to make it are running out of steam. There is no question about that. Yeah, there is, for instance, The impact of extra nitrogen fertilizer, if, you know, increase in nitrogen fertilizer, initially, of course, it had a huge impact, but that impact is leveling off. We can't just throw more fertilizer on the field. So again, you know, the biggest, I would say one of the biggest thing we can do for conservation of biodiversity is to develop genetically modified crops. Ironically, it's part of the environmental movement, which was the biggest obstacle and which really discouraged a lot of investment into research. Not all the investment, and also it confused some of the developing countries who do not have intellectual, you know, research capacity to evaluate these things into rejecting GMO. Not all of them, there are many of them actually which were very pragmatic and are using them. More incredibly, it also confused European society, which does have intellectual and scientific capacity for a fair evaluation, into rejecting GMO. And that's really a mistake of the highest order. So this is the poverty of the human population on the planet from early 19th century to 2015. And so you can see that we actually there the last 30 years has been economic miracle and in terms of reducing poverty, huge success. You don't typically hear that in the media. You know, it's all about impending poverty, all about the problems. But in fact, this was extremely good period of time. And, you know, very few people realize that, you know, you have different levels of wealth of people. And of course, the Chinese success plays a big part in these numbers. And you can say, well, yes, it's very nice, people are no longer poor, but that's exactly why China is creating all this pollution and other environmental issues. Well, that's true, but there is another part to that story, which we will see soon. Before we go to that part, let's have a look at some details. Okay, these are the number of people living in extreme poverty in 2013. And so you can see that India is the biggest one. And so again, we are coming back to the big question, what's going to happen with India? Whether, you know, India has every right to try to pull these 200 million people out of poverty, but of course that will have Chinese consequences in terms of environmental footprint. Then the next will be Nigeria. And we already discussed Nigeria, and then DR Congo and so on. But unfortunately, the next one is India. The Africa, unfortunately, does not look like very likely to pull out of poverty on massive scale anytime soon. So this is the perspective, and this is the prediction. Yeah, the prediction is that there will be a further decline in poverty, except for sub-Saharan Africa, which remains a problem. I mentioned that, you know, maybe some of you are surprised about the success in reducing poverty. Maybe you haven't realized that. Well, that is actually a more general problem. There is, in Great Britain, they ask only people with university degree. In the last 30 years, the proportion of the world population living in extreme poverty has increased, remained more or less the same, or decreased. And these are this is the response. And so, you know, only 12% of people knew the correct answer, and on a very basic level. Nobody's asking about percentages and numbers. This is asking whether it went down or up, and they failed it. This is actually one of the number of questions asked by Hans Rosling, and he is a biostatistician who promoted this, sort of rational approach to this data, and he produced a very good book, Factfulness, which is also translated to Czech. And he actually, we can call that Hans Rosling's chimp paradox, because as he pointed out, if you ask the same question chimpanzees, then they would pick up answer randomly. And so that means one third of the responses would be correct. While so people are not randomly people are not uninformed. Yeah, that would correspond indeed to 33% of correct answers on this. People are misinformed. And there are a number of questions like that. It's not only about the world poverty, which Han Rosling showed. Now, when we are talking about you know, maybe you think that we are talking too much about wealth and you know, living standards, poverty, but there is a very direct link to conservation, because the people who are dissatisfied with standards of living are not going to be receptive to environmental conservation, which might further diminish these standards of living. And for that, there has to be certain level of income for people to be satisfied. These are different countries, and percentage of people who are dissatisfied with their standards of living, you have to get at about 30,000 GDP with purchasing power adjusted to get a huge majority of satisfied people. And if you get below $10,000, then you are dealing with entirely unsatisfied population, and you basically can't have any kind of democratic decision on nature conservation. So these are these are really important issues. 10% makes satisfied 50% of population, and that's where we want to be. If we want to go further, then it will be $30,000. Now, we are talking about satisfaction with standards of living, but what about human happiness? Shouldn't we look into that? That's a bit of digression from conservation, I agree. But what about happiness? Yes. Money can buy you happiness. This is again GDP per capita and the life satisfaction per country, where people were asked to rate it on the scale from 2 to 10. And there is again a very, for a social phenomenon like happiness, this is actually a quite good correlation. However, happiness is expensive because the GDP per capita here is on logarithmic scale. So if you want to double your happiness, you have to invest a lot of money. So going back now, this economic digression had its purpose, as you will see. But let's return to the principal problem, and that is human population size. This is how you plot last 10,000 or 12,000 actually of population dynamics of people on arithmetic scale. And you can see how truly insane is the increase in population in the recent years. There is a internet counter, and so this is a bit out of date. March 2021, we had 7.8 billion people, and in one day there was population growth of 40,000 people. So basically, the 100,000 people city size of Budějovice will be added every 2.5 days to the population growth. So, of course, population growth modeled as a simple exponential process becomes always scary. And it's over the long time is rarely realistic. It's like, again, we are in the pandemics. You know that even COVID infection doesn't go exponentially. Even if you do no measurements, no mitigation, then it doesn't really go exponentially forever. And the same goes with population dynamics of people. But our goal is, of course, to modify it before it crashes. There is this famous story about how counterintuitive is exponential process by the story of a bet of playing chess game, where the player asks for reward in case he wins, and that was one grain of rice on the first field of the chessboard and then double it every next field and then progress throughout the whole 64 squares of the chessboard. So that means you have 2^63, which is 10^19 rice grains. And so this is an Indian story. And so that would bring 50 kilograms of rice per every square meter of the entire Indian territory. And so that shows the absurdity of that. Human population is growing 2% annually in countries where it grows fast. And that will mean that it will double every 35 years. Yeah, so we are in a similar situation where we can't do too many doublings like that. But of course, if you project this exponential process, of course, there was no way how this chess winner could get his reward. And likewise, lots of populist projection about population projecting this exponential dynamics, and often it is used in a political manner, like this kind of minority will overwhelm the whole country in 50 years this country will become whatever, Muslim, Buddhist, Christian, agnostic, black, yellow, white. You can make this kind of prediction because unless the population is perfectly steady, then with exponential growth, just modeled mechanically in the future, it will very soon either overwhelm entire planet or become extinct. For instance, look at the example. South Korea has currently the lowest fertility of 1.4 children per woman. And so its population will decline in 5 generations. That means it will decline from current 52 million to 8 million people. Niger, with the highest fertility, 6.9 children per woman per lifetime. In that case, in 5 generation, will increase from 23 million to 3.2 billion people. So you get into really unrealistic numbers. So what is actual history of the population growth and what is its future? Okay, this is the graph showing the number of people on Earth. Anything over 2018 is a projection in light blue, and the red line is the annual growth rate. And so what we have here in the 1960s, there was a real concern for panic because we were at 2.1%. And so that's 35 years is doubling population. And so the Paul Ehrlich, the one who lost the bet, published a very influential book, The Population Bomb. And there was a well-justified panic. Okay, everybody was panicking like nowadays with climate change, but nobody was doing anything. Yeah, the only country which did something was China, who instituted one-child policy in 1979. And that was actually, in response to this Western concerns, although China then was really not into the Western camp. It was, very pleasing for Western intellectuals, but nobody else did anything else. And although China was the largest country, it would not really make the desired impact. But to everybody's surprise, there was actually spontaneous decline in fertility rate until now, and it's projected to continue further. And so somehow basically miraculously resolve the population crisis by itself, with still the Earth overloaded with people, no question about it, but not catastrophically, because it projects that the population will probably peak later in this century. So first thing is that we did not really predict this slowdown. And so that means that we are unable to predict even population dynamics of our own species. Yeah, some people might ask then, okay, how reliable are predictions of global climate if we don't even predict our own population size, very successfully. The Chinese one-child policy did prevent a lot of births because, there is actually a dispute about how many. There is a study which tried to figure that out because there are also other factors. And so they compared China with India, Vietnam, and a basket of 16 countries which were similar to China in the 70s regarding the economic level and so on. And then they were looking at the population growth. And so there is official Chinese estimate is that it prevented 400 million births because, it prevented births to existing mothers, but also births to these prevented births. So this number of prevented births actually escalates over the time. This was internationally rejected as exaggeration, but this kind of recent analysis, which is published paper, suggested somewhere between 360 and 520 million prevented births. So it's actually confirmed the Chinese estimate, but it became very controversial. And sometimes on political basis, because the Chinese one-child policy is no longer fashionable in intellectual circles, and quite rightly so. It's no longer necessary. That's clear, and also it did have bad effect social ones, preventing people having their children, and also on the demography. The reason why China will have declining number of working population is exactly one-child policy. So then also there are some unexpected effects, especially selective abortions. Especially in Asia, including China, there is a strong desire to have at least one boy. And if you have one child policy, then the results are quite predictable. And so there is a proportion of boys as the first child, which is shown in the one child policy population. And then the ethnic minorities did not have that policy in China. And so they also had the proportion of boys at natural level. So this is clear example of manipulation. And of course, that creates a further host of social problems now. So what happens with population growth? There is a so-called demographic transition, where first there is a population steady because there is a high death rate and high birth rate. Then because of medical progress and general civilization progress, death rate goes down, but it's not followed by birth rate. And then birth rate goes down and establishes a balance on the more civilized, low mortality, low natality balance. Okay, so what leads to this decline in birth rates? That's a key question. And the demographic transition happened in England, basically at about 1900. Yeah, you can see that there was actually a population explosion in England and Wales as well, because at 1750, the birth rate remained steady, but the death rate, the mortality rate was declining. Sweden, the same. More recently, this is data for Mauritius, again, demographic transition. So what happens to human fertility? What factors are driving it going finally down? It's certainly not coercive politics like one-child policy, and it's certainly not wishful thinking or politicians telling you something. This is again the bubble graph. The bad news is that human fertility is not density dependent. Yeah, the higher density country will not stop reproducing only because they have high density of population. However, good news is that it's income dependent. And we are back why we are as a conservationist caring so much about money, because money solve the biggest problem, and that is population growth. Again, for, you know, this is the number of babies per lifetime per woman, and steady population is 2.1. Yeah, because there is some mortality of children, and there is some people who never reproduce, and so to replace replacement level, it's 2.1 children per woman. And this is the actual data. This is the income level per capita. And, you know, for a social phenomenon, which is based on private decisions of millions of families about whether to have children and how many, this is actually a remarkably nice correlation. So this is the, below that is already declining population. So you see lots of countries already have declining population. And if we want to get globally a stable population, we need to get income of about $12,000 per capita for everybody. And then, so that's where Sri Lanka is now. So we need to get Sri Lankan lifestyle for everybody, and that will solve the population problem. This is the current situation, but these are also the trajectories, individual countries in time. And again, babies per woman against GP per capita throughout the years for 55 developing countries. There are some strange exceptions, but generally, again, it's remarkable how different countries, Christian, Buddhist, Muslim, very poor, a little bit less poor, African, American, Asian, they all basically follow the same trajectory, and the number of children goes down very fast with relatively modest increase in income. And that's the main issue. We need to get developing countries a little bit richer, not necessarily Switzerland type of rich, and we solve the population increase problem. This demographic transition, you can see babies per woman. This was the situation in 1950, where it was always known that very rich countries have low population growth, but nobody realized how little it needs to improve for the developing country to stop growing. So in 1950s, you had clearly developed countries, mostly Europe, and the bunch of developing countries. But then everybody went this direction towards lower fertility. And then here, this is the babies per woman against child mortality. So that's another correlation. You know, the income is not only one. That's also a problem, that you have a lot of social correlations with education, mortality, length of life. It's all correlated, but income is the fact which you can manipulate. So here, everybody went to a more civilized corner of lower children mortality, but at a different rate. And so this is the current situation. So you see that there are no longer two clusters of countries. You can't say that there are developed and developing countries, because there is now the developed countries improved. Lots of developing countries of before improved and caught up with them. And then lots of them are in the middle, and some really stayed stagnant. And so you can also see the separation of blue color, which is Africa. So unfortunately, Africa remains the problem. Yeah, now you can say, well, if there is high children mortality, it's bad, of course, but doesn't it help with reducing population growth? Not at all, because the countries with the highest child mortality are growing the fastest. Why is that? Because people overcompensate. If you see that there is some likelihood that your children will die, you have more than will actually die, and so you overcompensate. This is example here. The blue example, there is 100 mothers will have lifetime fertility 200, you know, if they have 200 babies, then two of them die and 198 live. Yeah, that's the low child mortality scenario. If you have the high mortality scenario, then 100 mothers, that's the green one, 100 mothers will have 520 babies, yeah, 5.2 babies per mother. So, and then based on child mortality, 52 of them die, and so 468 live. So paradoxically, high child mortality means high increase in population. Okay, this is again the same correlation, but this is trajectory of time for certain countries. Yeah, so Nigeria started 1950, high mortality, high lifetime fertility, and move little bit towards better combination, but not much. Brazil started 1950 here, and then went all the way here, and so, and this is the trajectory for France. And so Brazil now is at the same situation demographically like Brazil was in, like France was in 1990. And Nigeria now is in the same situation and Brazil was in 1968. Yeah, so, you know, if you think of Brazil, demographically, it's basically like you most of you will, you know, be born after 1990, but it's basically the not so long ago when you were born in Europe. So this is sort of European demography. Also, long living people have fewer children. Yeah, again, same development, and again, Africa lagging behind. So this is a modern model where you have also education, but it all goes with income. So, you know, this is the number of education years for girls. And then there is also access of contraceptives. And so these individual levels are how much is the need for contraceptions, which is given by views of people, is met. If people have full access to contraception, then that's the black line, and then you go up. So for the same level of education, you can have different total fertility depending on access to contraceptives. But at the same time, there is a general decline in fertility with education. So again, sustainable population in these terms means full access to contraceptives and at least 10 years education for all women. And again, with that, we will get a sustainable population. Again, these are trajectories of individual countries, fertility against female literacy rate. So birth control, it's actually an issue which, you know, in Europe is not a big issue. There is you know, availability, but not everywhere in the world is it like that. There is people are asked how many children they want and how many they have. And for instance, you know, people always have more children than they say they want, but that differential is much higher in Africa. People in Africa want to have more children than people in Asia or South America, but they have double that, which is much bigger difference than here. There are also, you know, questions, men and women can have different views on how many children and so on, but many women have unmet needs for contraception, yeah? And so, when you look at different factors preventing contraceptive use, it's not that people don't know or that its cost is too high. Again, that's what you would think, but it's that either themselves are opposed or their partners, or that for different reasons, religious or cultural and so on, or that they are afraid of side effects. So you can't really do much about that, especially, but it's actually, yes, there are some side effects, but unfortunately, it's almost impossible to develop new hormonal contraceptives. This is the view of actually the discoverer of the current contraceptives, Carl Gerasi, in his interesting book, basically explains that in current pharmaceutical industry, where contraceptives are doubtful profitability and difficult to test for side effects and politically problematic in some countries, there are no incentives to developing better contraceptives. So unfortunately, this factor of side effects will probably stay for time to come. There are Marie Stopes International. Okay, they are trying to do awareness about the contraceptives. And so what is the future with all these factors? Okay, these are United Nations projections of population growth. There is a huge range, but the median projection shows that the population will peak at about 11 billion people, which is too many, but still, not complete disaster. And these are the projection for babies per woman. Again, all scenarios basically predict that it will decline in a different rate. These are the predicted trajectories. So all continents are insignificant except for Asia and Africa. And Asia is definitely going to go down in terms of population within this century. Africa, however, there are much more broader range of scenarios, and many of them show that the future development will be driven, population development will be driven by Africa. And it depends on what happens on that continent in terms of especially economy. So these are different scenarios, and some of them are actually going to continuing growth beyond 11 billion people, and that will be solely because of Africa and different scenarios there, which are very, very much very much variable. And so, these are scenarios for different countries. So in China, no matter what happens, given her demography, it will go down. India with some delay as well, US as well, but Nigeria and Congo have all options open, from going slowly down, peaking in this century, going down, to going up and up and up. Yeah, and so you can say that this is the rate when the reproductive level falls below replacement level. In dark violet countries, it already happened. And in all countries which are not different shade of red, it will happen before the middle of the century. So basically everywhere except some African countries. So you can say that what happened with the main conservation problem what happens in Africa. And especially whether we somehow manage to get Africa to be rich. That's basically, rather surprisingly maybe for somebody, the key question of future conservation of biodiversity is whether Africa get rich. And the answer is yes, it should get rich, even if it has temporary negative environmental consequences. So to finish, 9 conclusions to the primary problem. Good news, human fertility is income dependent. More good news, in 30 years, many people were lifted from poverty, saving us overpopulation catastrophe. Ozone hole lesson, technology, not social engineering, solves environmental problems. Conservation is not a religion towards ascetic lifestyle or cultivating apocalyptic expectations, which unfortunately is sometimes the case. Techno-optimism, technology to solve pressing environmental problems and of course cause new ones, unless stifled by two precautionary approach. Precautionary approach, another concept of environmental science, is one of the worst concepts you can think about. Technology to create wealth necessary to keep the global population falling. Sri Lankan's lifestyle for everybody. And access to contraceptives and 10 years of education for all women, and whether the world will overpopulate or not in the 21st century is in the hands of Africans. Okay, that's all from me about conservation and future of the planet. Thank you for